Welcome to Causes TV, which comes to you from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. It is my pleasure to welcome you to today's lecture in our series of occasional lecture topics. Dr. Arora, thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. O'Hara, for this wonderful opportunity. And you have such varied interests amongst all the students and all the faculty over here. So, and they all have some sort of interest or some linkages towards supply chain. So that's really, really interesting and very, very exciting. So I'm really happy to be here and thank you once again for this opportunity.
My pleasure.
I'll just share my screen with you all. Okay, all right, yeah. So once again, very good afternoon to all of you. I'm Amit Arora. I'm an Associate Professor of Supply Chain Management at the School of Business and Public Administration. And so the agenda of today's presentation, I'll just give a brief introduction about myself, my education and corporate experience. I'll talk about my research interests, a brief overview, a brief understanding of what exactly supply chain management is. I know many of you are familiar with it. Some of you may not be. So it's a sort of a refresher at a from a very high level, you know, what supply chain management is all about. I'll give a research presentation on one of the research papers that I've been working on, and it's finished now. It has actually been submitted and under the first round of review at a journal. Then I'll talk a little bit about the industry trends and some research topics which are relevant to the industry these days in the field of supply chains. And then in the end, probably we'll have a short, you know, fun quiz sort of a thing. I discovered this this tool, Kahoot, during this, you know, when we all switched to online learning and teaching, and I found this tool to be useful. So I'm going to test this on all of you today, right? No one's going to be graded, right? So it's just a fun thing. So you don't have to really worry about anything. So it's going to be a fun thing about logistics and transportation and all. So, and please feel free to, you know, interrupt me if you have any questions or anything. Feel free, you know, we can have a sort of an interaction rather than me just talking. So we can have it, have a more interactive session. So that will be beneficial to everyone, right? So starting off with my education. So I was born and brought up in India, and I did my all my schooling and my initial college. All of that was done in India. My educational background is my undergrad degree is in mechanical engineering, and then I did my master's in energy and environmental management. Both of these degrees are from India. And then I moved to US about 12 to 13 years ago, and I enrolled myself for a PhD program at Georgia Southern University, that's in Georgia. I used to live in Savannah, which is it's a coastal city, and I used to go for my classes to Statesboro, which is about 70 miles from Savannah. So I used to commute back and forth. Finally, I finished my PhD in the area of logistics and supply chain management. This was in 2014 with a minor in operations management. During my PhD as a student, I also had the opportunity to earn my SCORE certification, that Supply Chain Operations Reference Certification. SCORE is, this was awarded by SCC, that's Supply Chain Council, which is now merged with APEX, that's American Production and Inventory Control Society. So it's a huge society, APEX. There were these two organizations, two very big organizations, APEX and SCC, and they both have now merged with each other. So I got this opportunity to earn this certification while doing my PhD. So during my PhD, I used to teach also. I received a fellowship, so it was part of my responsibility to teach a course independently, not as a teaching assistant, but as a full-fledged instructor. an underpaid instructor. So that's about my educational background. I worked in the industry for about 10 years. So as soon as I finished off with my bachelor's in mechanical engineering, at that time, the Indian economy was opening up. That was, you know, mid 90s to late 90s is when the Indian economy was opening up to the world. And the auto industry was really flourishing in India. So before the economy opened up, there were just probably two auto manufacturers, domestic auto manufacturers, and there were lots of inefficiencies, a lot of waiting time, no control over quality. But then towards 97, 96 is when the Indian economy opened up and the Indian auto sector opened up to the world economy. So there was a rush of all the auto manufacturers to set up their manufacturing plants in India. Hyundai was one of them. Hyundai, it's a Korean company headquartered in Seoul in South Korea. And they set up their 100% subsidiary in India. So they had their manufacturing plant in the southern part of India, and they had their corporate headquarters in the capital of India, which is New Delhi. So it was my dream at that time to, you know, work for an automobile company. And I got this opportunity. So I joined as a trainee engineer in Hyundai Motor India in the year 1999. And Hyundai, even though it was an established multinational corporation in India, it was more like a startup company, right? So we had long working hours. And as a trainee, you know, I got the opportunity to, you know, have my hands dirty in every aspect of automobile manufacturing, the customer side, the vendor side. So sort of without knowing, I just got into the supply chain of the automobile industry. I worked there for about 7 years at Hyundai, and then I moved on to Honda. That's a Japanese company headquartered in Tokyo, Japan, and it's a multinational organization. So from a Korean company, I moved to a Japanese company. Very different style of working, very different strategies these two companies had. So it was, even though both were from the Asian part of the world, but the strategies of both the companies was totally different. So I had the opportunity to work for both of these, had Japanese bosses and Korean bosses. It was really fun to work with all of them. Moving on to my research interests. So I've done some work on supply chain strategy part. And again, in the strategy part, I do some research in the sustainable supply chain strategies and on more on the economic side of supply chain strategies. So both of these. I've got a few papers published in supply chain journals. The most recent one, it just came out a few months ago. It's on strategic supply, strategic sustainable purchasing, environmental collaboration, and organizational sustainability performance. The topic that I'll be hitting on today is the one that you see at the bottom. So measuring the effect of market turbulence on supply chain collaboration and performance outcomes. So if you look at the term sustainability, right, it's a broad term, specifically consisting of three main pillars. You've got the economic pillar, the environmental pillar, and the social pillar, right? So all of them come together. So that's how sustainability is defined these days, right? The one that I have at the bottom, it's more towards the economic pillar of sustainability. So I'll be presenting my research on this one today. Sustainable supply chains, that's another area. This was my dissertation topic, sustainable supply chains. I have a few papers that I'm working on with some of my colleagues in UDC and beyond UDC. So I'm really interested in sustainable supply chains also. I also have some interest in interdisciplinary teaching. So I've got a couple of papers published in pedagogical journals. So as Dr. Huera was saying that, you know, my wife also works at the School of Business and Public Administration. She's a marketing professor. So both of us have the opportunity to, you know, write some papers together. So she's a marketing professor, I'm a supply chain person. So, you know, there are intersections of both these disciplines. We have the opportunity to publish a few papers with her, especially in this field of pedagogy and teaching. Okay, so that was a brief introduction about myself and my research interests. Let's switch gears and let's talk about what is supply chain management. So I would just put it simply that, you know, anything that you see, any product that you see, anything that you touch, anything you want to buy has a supply chain behind it, right? So, you know, we can understand this concept of supply chain management with the help of, a very simple product. Let's say a water bottle, right? So if we have to look at the story, the supply chain story of a water bottle, what's it going to be? So for a bottle of water, to produce a bottle of water, what do you really need, right? You need a plastic bottle, right? You need fresh, clean water, drinking water. You need the plastic caps that go on top of it, right? You need this the label, right? And that's what makes a bottle of water. And where do you buy this bottle of water from? You either go to a vending machine, maybe in UDC, or at an airport or wherever a vending machine is, or you go to a grocery store and you buy water from there, right? So the price of a bottle, water bottle, it's about $1.50, depends on where you're buying it from. If it's a vending machine, probably it's 99 cents. If it is at the airport, probably it's $2.50, $2.50. If you buy a whole pack of 24 bottles, it works out to be much cheaper. Right? So approximate price about $1.50, right? So what do you think is the profit on a bottle of water? Anyone? So you buy a bottle of water for about, you know, $1.50.
20 cents maybe? 10 to 20 cents?
Yeah, 25 cents.
25 cents. Any other guesses?
50 cents.
50 cents, okay, great.
A dollar, $1.
A dollar, okay. Anyone else?
We have someone in the chat saying 70%.
70%, okay, great. Great answer.
And I'm moving in to sell a bottle of water.
Exactly. If you think you can make 75 cents or 70% or $1 on a bottle of water, we should all, you know, resign from our jobs and get into the business of making water and selling water, right? But the hard reality is that the profit that you have on a bottle of water is just a few cents, right? Maybe 10 cents or even less, right? So that's really surprising, right? That's really eye-opening, right? We all were thinking that, you know, what goes in the bottle of water, right? It's just a plastic bottle and you've got some water in it, clean water, and some attractive packaging. And then you label it, you brand it, and you sell it, right? So I should be making a lot of profit, but it does not happen that way, right? So the profit margins on any product, which is like a commodity, the cost pressures are really, really high, right? So where did all the profit go? So the answer lies in understanding from a business perspective, how the bottle of water got to you and to me as a customer, how did it really get to us, right? And the product cost, it's very important to understand that the product cost is not equal to the material cost, right? So let's look at it, you know, the whole supply chain of the making of a water bottle and how it really gets to you and me, right? So first of all, we have the raw material, right? So we've got the plastic bottles, we've got the plastic caps, and we've got those labels, and they are all purchased in bulk from our suppliers, right? So you've got you've got all these raw materials that you place the order on your suppliers or your vendors, right? And then that all that bulk material that has been purchased has to be transported from the supplier to your bottling plant, right? So in the transportation at the vendor end, in order to make that happen, you'll have probably forklifts, right? You'll have trucks to move all that raw material from the vendor facility to your manufacturing facility or your bottling facility, right? To run those trucks, you have employees, your truck drivers, right? You'll need fuel for that. You'll need insurance for all the operations, right? So that all is adding up to the cost, right? Once all that is transported, it gets to your bottling plant, and then what all do you need to run your bottling plant, right? You need the assembly line, the conveyor belts and all, right? You need employees to run that plant, right? Remember, you're not just manufacturing one bottle of water, right? That's obviously not going to happen, right? You have to produce like hundreds of thousands to make your operations like cost effective, right? You'll need electricity to run that plant, the bottling plant. You'll need office space for your employees. You'll need all the office products, the office stationery, everything to run the bottling plant, right? From the bottling plant, once you know everything has been bottled and you've got this final finished product in your bottling plant, then it has to go to the distribution centers, right? Again, at the distribution center, you need to transport everything from the bottling plant to the distribution center, right? So again, you'll probably need forklifts. You'll need trucks for the transportation. You'll need truck drivers. You'll need fuel to run all that. You need insurance for your employees for all the product, right? So all that is now adding to the cost, right? From the distribution center, your product is going to go to the retail stores, maybe the grocery stores or Walmart or Target, right? These are the retail stores where you and I as customers will go to buy. Again, the retail store, you have to have a facility, right? You have to have employees to run the retail store. You'll need electricity to run it. You'll need office space. You'll need some sort of a security to make sure that all your inventory is protected. You'll need insurance for the employees, for all the inventory that you have in your grocery store, right? And don't forget the returns. Right, so you also have a reverse logistics in case a product is bad or the product was bought by mistake by the customer. It has to be returned. Maybe the bottle was totally damaged. The whole case was damaged. The customer is going to return it to the retail store, right? And from the retail store, it goes back up the supply chain. So the retains the returns are also there. Again, if you return one bottle of water immediately. That bottle of water is not going to go back to up the supply chain, right? You'll probably wait for a sufficient mass and then you're going to initiate the returns, right? So for that, again, you'll probably need forklifts, you'll need trucks, you'll need truck drivers, you'll need the fuel, you'll need all the insurance, right? To make sure that your returns are as smooth as possible, right? And don't forget the customer service. Generally on the label that you see over here, there will be a customer service number, a 1-800 number, right? In case of any complaints or any queries, contact us on such and such number, an 800 number again. So for that customer service, you need employees to run the customer service operations. All that is going to add up to the costs, right? So in the end, all these processes, right? So all the way from the supplier to the bottling plant, to the warehouses, to the retail stores, and then finally to you and me, right? And then you have an opposite process too, the reverse logistics part, right? So you've got different processes happening in this entire supply chain of a very simple product, which is a bottle of water, right? So all these processes, they need to be efficient, they need to be cost effective, right? And whose job is it to make it happen? It's a supply chain manager's. That's what supply chain professionals do. That's what supply chain managers do, right? First of all, understand all the processes and then root out the inefficiencies in the process to make sure that you have a healthy bottom line, right? So this is what a supply chain looks like, right? So right from the supplier end to the manufacturing, and then you have packaging, finishing, your distribution, your retail, or the sales, and then finally the customer, right? So there are basically three types of flows that happen in a supply chain. You've got the product flow, of course, right? And then there are also service supply chains. Whenever we think of supply chains, we generally think of products, right? But then there are service supply chains too. For example, in the service industry, right? Hospitality, in the healthcare, right? So all of that would have more of a service supply chains. You have another flow called the cash flow, the money flow, right? So money is flowing up and down the supply chain, right? There is also the information flow, and that is very, very critical. You need to really have transparent supply chains to make sure to understand where all your inventory is, right? So supply chains have been in the news recently. In the pandemic, we saw that, you know, the toilet papers, not available. The paper towels, just not available. Shortage of food items. You go to a grocery store, you had empty shelves, right? So what was happening? Everyone was talking about supply chains, right? So that information part is very, very important. What is really happening? Is it just a small spike, which is going to go down? Or is it like a permanent shift in the taste of the consumers? Consumers probably now are buying more frozen products. Suddenly there has been a shift, right? So the supply chains, they have to be really agile, really flexible to really meet that demand. And we saw all the supply chains getting really squeezed and under tension when all this happened, right? I know someone while introducing herself, she was saying that the COVID-19 vaccine, right? So we've got those last mile delivery challenges. I mean, maybe the manufacturers are able to produce, you know, millions, they don't have any problem. But how is that COVID-19 vaccine, how is it going to get from the manufacturer to the distribution centers all across the world, and then finally to the customers, where we get the shot in the arm, right? It has to be maintained at a specific temperature. And what I've heard is like, you need really low temperatures for that. You need very special glass containers to retain the effectiveness of the vaccine. So all of that is going to be challenging, right? And who's going to take care of that? It's all about logistics and supply chain, right? So we are looking at this, a simple figure of a supply chain where it starts from the supplier and goes to the manufacturers, goes to the distribution centers, the retail stores, and then finally to the customers, right? So which one do you think is the most important entity? You've got different entities in a supply chain. Which one do you think is the most important entity in a supply chain? Anyone? So you've got different entities, suppliers, manufacturers, distributors, retailers, customers, right? So which one is the most important entity in a supply chain?
I'm going to go out on a limb. I can't tell that they say all seem important because it's linked.
Mm-hmm. All seem important, right? But which one is the most important?
Mm-hmm.
Distribution.
Okay.
I think customers, because customers have to actually want what you want the supply chain to provide. And I think a lot of times people misjudge what customers actually want. And so they spend all this money putting all these links together, and there's nothing at the end that says it's all for something useful.
Okay. I have a second on that. Sorry, go ahead. Sorry.
No, I was just going to agree that I think the customers kind of drive the chain. So they are the most important.
Okay.
And we've got a third vote for that in the chat. That okay. Also customer.
So customers, and then someone said distribution. Any other answers?
I'll get manufacturing.
Manufacturers. Okay. They are the ones who are really producing the goods. Okay. Manufacturers.
Suppliers.
Suppliers. Okay. Now we're going to the supplier end. Okay. So someone said supplier, someone said manufacturing, someone said distribution, and some said customer, right? Now, the most—
I think that finishing is a really important part.
Finishing?
Yeah, because it's kind of a toss up between finishing and customers, because they also, they're kind of like that final step in what the customer wants in a way, so.
Okay. So it's not evenly like spread out, right? So everyone says, you know, someone is saying suppliers, manufacturers, finishing, distribution, sales, and at least three say customer, right? So the right answer is actually customer. And why customer? Because if you think about a supply chain, the only entity that is putting in money in the supply chain is the customer, right? Everyone else is just recycling that money up the supply chain, right? That's why we always say in the world of business, like, you know, the customer is the most important. Customer is the king or customer is the queen, right? So because they are the only ones who put in the money in the supply chain. Rest, everyone is just recycling that money.
Not only that, every supply chain ever created is really just an extension of what someone can do for themselves. The only reason that supply chains exist is because it became inefficient for people to do everything for themselves.
That's right.
Those so prime movers.
Organizations, if you look at the organizations earlier in the world of business, let's say, you know, when the first automobile was produced by Ford way back in 1896, you had vertically integrated supply chains. What that means is that the auto manufacturer used to control every aspect of production, right from the steel producing mills to nuts and bolts to everything. It, slowly and steadily, that became, you know, when the volumes increased, it became a little inefficient to do everything on your own. So companies started outsourcing some of their production activities or some of their other activities, component manufacturing activities, to other contract manufacturers. And that gave the rise to supply chain management, right? So what a company does is they'll retain their core competency and they're going to outsource what they think does not really add value to their business processes, right? Now, if you look at an auto manufacturer, I mean, if you look at Honda or Hyundai or Ford, many of their components are manufactured by outside vendors, right? So they'll have a vendor for windshield glass. They'll have a vendor for brake assembly. They'll have a vendor for your tires, right? And what the auto companies probably would retain. So let's take the example of Honda. What they really retain is their core competency, and Honda's core competency is its engine technology. Right, so they're not going to give away their manufacturing of engines to any other supplier or any contract manufacturer. Rest of the stuff they do, right? Other examples of companies like Nike, right? So Nike's core competency is more into research and development and marketing, right? They have outsourced their production processes to the contract manufacturers, right? So they have set up assembly plants in other countries, but what they are really focused on is, you know, designing, research and development and design and the marketing aspects, right? So that's how this whole notion of supply chain management really came into existence, right? To root out inefficiencies. It's going to become really, really inefficient for a manufacturing company if they are doing everything producing on their own, nuts and bolts to little parts to everything, right? So, yeah. Okay, so I think we have a good understanding of what really a supply chain is. And really think about it, you know, next time you go out to buy anything, you know, maybe a shirt or a bottle of water or a pen or something, think about the supply chain story behind it, right? How this pen really, or the shoe that you wear, right? So probably the shoes that you wear, maybe they are made somewhere in Vietnam, right? But how did that shoe, which was made in Vietnam, how did it get to a store in Washington, D.C., right? So probably the sole of the shoe that was made somewhere in Eastern Europe, the leather part was probably made somewhere in Asia. The shoe laces were probably made somewhere in Southeast Asia or in Africa. And all of that got together at a plant in Vietnam where everything was assembled together. And then from Vietnam, it was transported by an ocean container, by ship, to the East Coast of US, maybe somewhere in New York. And then from New York by rail, it went to a distribution center. From the distribution center, it got to a retail store somewhere in downtown DC or in the DC metro area where you and I just went and bought that pair of shoe, right? So everything that we see or touch or buy has a supply chain story behind it. So next time when you buy a product, just spend like a minute to think about how that product really got to you and me. So that's the sort of an understanding of the supply chain concept.
Oh, Dr. Arora, just on your last slide, I was curious, the part you said, the bullwhip effect. What is that?
Yes, so that's an interesting phenomena, the bullwhip effect. And I don't have any slides on it, but I wish I had included that. It's a very interesting phenomenon. So just to give you a brief overview of what a bullwhip effect is, let's take the example of another simple product like diapers, right? So we probably all have used diapers for our kids or for for anyone in the family, right? So it's a very common product, diapers. Let's take the example of Pampers, right? So Pampers is made by Procter & Gamble, and you can easily go to Walmart to buy a box of Pampers, right? So who are the end users of diapers? The end users of diapers?
The people who are in them and the people who buy them, right?
That's right, right? So maybe let's say babies, right?
Babies,
so,
sure.
Yeah, babies are the end users of diapers, right? So, and they have like a fixed demand, right? Unless the baby gets sick or has an upset stomach or something like that, maybe the demand is going to go up. Otherwise, as a parent, I know how many to buy in a week, right? So maybe it's two boxes per week or something like that, right? So, so the babies, if it's a normal baby, no problem, no sickness, their demand is pretty good. It's going to be pretty much constant, right? But let's say, who are the buyers? The end users are the babies and the buyers are parents, right? So as parents, probably, maybe I decided one day that, let me just buy one extra box of Pampers just in case, I want to have some extra inventory at my house. Something might just happen, right? So maybe I have to go out of town or whatever. So I'm going to buy one extra box. And let's assume hypothetically that every parent in the Washington DC metro area, they decide they're gonna buy one extra box of diapers, right? Where do parents go to buy diapers? Go to a big box store, maybe Walmart, right? Low prices, everyday low prices, live better, right? So I'll just go there and instead of buying two boxes for the week, I'm gonna buy three boxes. And you've got like hundreds and thousands of parents who decide to, buy just one extra box, right? So now at Walmart, all across the DC area, the DC metro area, they see a spike in the demand, right? So they have a very good inventory management system and they have a real-time tracking of what's really selling and what is not. And suddenly, the managers at Walmart stores, they see that there's a spike in the demand for diapers, right? So what they're going to do, they are going to give the feedback to the headquarters in Bentonville, Arkansas, where the Walmart headquarters are, that there is a spike in demand for diapers, right? So what's Walmart going to do? They are going to get in touch with their supplier. That's Procter & Gamble, the manufacturer of diapers. And they are going to say, hey, we need to ramp up your production. We need more orders. They are coming in. We are going to double our orders for the next month. So you ramp up your production. What does Procter & Gamble, the makers of Pampers, they say, okay, Walmart is one of our biggest customers. They've asked for this. We're going to ramp up our production. We're going to have three shifts a day, ramp it up, and we're going to produce more diapers, right? Now, all this while, the babies, the end users, they are like sweet little babies. They have not demanded anything more. It's just that, one parent panicked and then everyone panicked and they thought, let's just get one extra box of diapers. But the end user is not complaining. Their demand is pretty much constant, right? But what is happening up the supply chain? Procter & Gamble then says, okay, now we need raw materials. So, the supplier to Procter & Gamble, the cotton liner material that is there in the diapers, that's supplied by 3M. That's another company, 3M, right? So they place more orders on 3M and 3M says, okay, Procter & Gamble, one of our great customers, we're going to ramp up that production of cotton liners. And, so what really happened was the end user did not demand anything more, but then that little spike that was, it created a ripple effect across the entire supply chain. It was sort of a false thing, right? So the demand was pretty much constant, right? So that's what your bullwhip effect is. And that's what we saw during the pandemic, right? When, your demand for toilet papers, it's still constant, but we all decided to just hoard the toilet papers, right? And it was like a mass hysteria that was created that, you know, so everyone stocked up next 6 months of stock or maybe 1 year's worth of stock of toilet paper and everything was off the shelf, right? That caused a strain in the entire supply chain. So that effect is called the bullwhip effect. Every industry has it. Sometimes it has a very large magnitude, what happened during this pandemic in the month of April, May, right? Sometimes it has a much shorter effect, right? But that's how do you mitigate that bullwhip effect? That's through your information systems, right? So you need to have a sort of a 50,000 foot level view of your entire supply chain to really understand how is the inventory flowing, where is the demand really actually happening, and how do you make that happen? These big companies, they've got these ERP systems, enterprise resource planning systems, that really connect each and every part of their organization and their supply chain network through a system to, and they have real-time information about how the products are really flowing. Right. So did I answer your question? I mean, it was probably a long answer.
Yes.
to the bullwhip effect, but hopefully it gave you some sort of a big brief overview of what bullwhip effect is.
So this is Tanya. I have a quick question and as a follow-on to that. So when they're looking at a high level about the whole resource chain to try to figure out where that demand might be actually occurring, how would they factor in the fact that the end user, which is the baby, hasn't really changed their consumption? How do they figure that out? Because do they have a pulse into the buyer and the end user?
Yeah, so forecasting demand is a critical part of your supply chain, right? What we can forecast or really see is how much is being bought, how much is being consumed at home that we don't have a control over, right? So when you forecast demand, or you make all these forecasts for the next 6 months and you look at the historical demand data, that's at the point of sale, right? How much is actually being sold? Now, how much is actually being consumed? In this case, you know, the babies, how much they are consuming, and that's difficult to judge, right? So how much you are really hoarding or how much you're just gonna waste and throw away, that we don't have really control over. The businesses won't have control over. Control over the point of sale, actually what is being sold, right?
Okay, so they would just look at the historical sales.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But to predict demand for such an event like the pandemic, which is like a 1 in 100 year event, they call it a black swan event, right? So these black swan events, which are really hard to predict, all the models are going to fail. And that's what really happened during this, you know, in the month of March, April. You know, everyone was at home, everyone started baking. So there was shortage of flour, shortage of toilet papers, right? So that's a black swan event. It's really hard to predict which way the things are really gonna go. So that's one of the challenges in a supply chain. Right. All right, any other questions before we move on to the next part of the presentation? Okay, all right. Okay, so let's switch gears, and I'm going to talk about one of my the research papers that I was working on. It's called Measuring the Effect of Market Turbulence on Supply Chain Collaboration and Performance Outcomes. So collaboration between the firms in a supply chain, there has been a lot of research that has been done in this area. Why firms collaborate, how do firms collaborate, what are the benefits of collaboration, right? And we all understand now, going by the previous slides, that there are different organizations involved in a supply chain. The better they are able to collaborate with each other, the more chances of a successful supply chain we'll have, right? So collaboration has become a critical component for the smooth functioning of an efficient supply chain, right? So we all understand the importance of supply chain. To give you an example, we talked about Walmart and Procter & Gamble in the previous slides, right? So if you look at, this is one of the, and there are numerous examples in the world of business that how collaborative relationships, they are beneficial to all the entities in a supply chain. And example is Procter & Gamble and Walmart. So if you look at this figure right here, so if you look at Procter & Gamble, which is highlighted in yellow, so their business with Walmart is worth more than $10 billion. And in terms of percentage, about 14% of the revenue of Procter & Gamble comes from Walmart, right? So billions of dollars worth of business between these two entities. So, and they have been, and there are numerous other examples of, you know, successful collaboration, supply chain collaboration between organizations. However, there seems to be some limited research on the effect of market turbulence on collaboration and firm performance. So when we talk about market turbulence, this is a term which is a concept which is borrowed from marketing literature. And I'll talk about what market turbulence is all about. It's all about, you know, turbulence on the demand side, changing tastes of customers, new customers coming into the supply chains, right? So instead of having a very predictable business scenario, you have a turbulent scenario, right? That's what market turbulence is all about. So there seems to be limited research on the effect of market turbulence on supply chain collaboration and performance of the firm, right? So that's the whole, the big purpose of this research, to propose and empirically test a model illustrating the effect of market turbulence on the supply chain collaboration levels between partner firms and its outcomes in terms of relational outcomes and operational outcomes, which impact, finally, they have an impact on the firm performance. Oops. So a specific research question that we are looking at in this research is, what is the effect of market turbulence on the relationship between supply chain collaboration and its outcomes? And to help answer this question, this research question, we make use of conflicting insights from three different theories, the behavioral theory, the contingency theory, and the relational view. And these three theories are used to develop a conceptual model. And then we finally empirically test this conceptual model to test how relationships fare when market turbulence is present in the business environment. So just to give you a brief background about the theories that have been used in this research, the first one is behavioral theory. This was propagated way back in 1963 by Syatt and March, but this theory still holds and it's still used in the world of business today. And this theory states that business organizations, they avoid uncertainty in their environment by arranging for negotiated environments using standard operating procedures. They will have uncertainty absorbing contracts. They will avoid planning where plan depends on prediction of uncertain future events. They always emphasize, organizations will emphasize in solving short-term problems. They'll come up with some decision rules and standard operating procedures to avoid uncertainty in the external environment. Then we have the structural contingency theory given by Lawrence and Lorsch. It says that the best way to organize an organization is contingent on the external environment. If the environment is stable, it's very predictable, then the organizational structural form is going to be very centralized, which will have very clear goals. In case the environment is turbulent, if there is market turbulence present in the environment, then the structural form is going to be very informal. It will have ambiguous goals, and that can, you know, negatively impact the relations between the companies. So that's what structural contingency theory is all about. The third theory that we use in this research is relational view. Relational view, this focuses on examining the network of relationships in which the firm is embedded. So it states that the competitive advantage of a firm exists in the relationships in which the firm is embedded. If you have strong relationships, that will enable the firm to access additional financial resources, intellectual resources, human capital resources with each other, right? So the strategy of a firm to engage supply chain partners in positive relationships, the key word here is the relationships. If you have good relationships, that's going to be a source of competitive advantage for the firms, right? So you've got these three different theories. So the relational view, it seems to suggest the third theory that we talked about. So that seems to suggest that regardless of any market turbulence in the environment, if the relationships between the firms are strong, then that will offer a sustained competitive advantage over the competition. Behavioral theory, on the other hand, it suggests that market turbulence is going to positively affect the collaboration and operational performance link, because companies will try to arrange for a negotiated environment. They'll have some decision rules. They'll have standard operating procedures. So therefore, behavioral theory, it seems to suggest that if there is market turbulence present in the environment, then that's going to positively moderate the relationship between collaboration and operational performance. Contingency theory, on the other hand, it seems to suggest that market turbulence will negatively affect the collaboration and relational performance link. Again, going by the theory, it's all about, you know, if there's market turbulence present, you'll have unambiguous goals. There'll be no formal structure. There'll be no clear thinking. So maybe the relationships between the firms and the collaboration between the firms, that is going to be negatively affected, right? So three different theories, three different conflicting insights. So we decided that this is going to be an interesting thing to see, that, you know, if we introduce this market turbulence in your supply chain, how does that really affect the performance of the firms? So that's a theoretical framework. We have our hypothesis one, which says that supply chain collaboration would lead to better relational outcomes. And relational outcomes are in terms of, you know, trusting your supply chain partners, having respect for your supply chain partners, right? So that's about relational outcomes. The second hypothesis is better supply chain collaboration between the firms would lead to better operational outcomes. And again, operational outcomes in terms of cost, in terms of quality, right? So all of those operational aspects of an organization or of the supply chain. Third hypothesis is better relational outcomes would lead to better operational outcomes. Fourth hypothesis, we introduce this concept of, or the construct of market turbulence. And as I explained in the previous slide, we hypothesized that market turbulence is going to positively moderate the relationship between supply chain collaboration level and the operational outcomes. And hypothesis number five, as we discussed in the previous slide, market turbulence is going to negatively moderate the relationship between supply chain collaboration and relational outcomes. So in effect, what we are doing is we are testing the behavioral theory in hypothesis four and the structural contingency theory in hypothesis five. Hypothesis six is towards the performance of the firm. Better operational outcomes would lead to better financial and market performance of the firm. So when we're talking about the performance of a firm, it's got to do with two aspects of performance. One is the financial performance and other is the market performance in terms of market share and all. And the last hypothesis, the seventh hypothesis, is that better relational outcomes would lead to better organizational performance of the firm. So that's our conceptual framework, a total of seven hypotheses. And to test to empirically test it, we designed a questionnaire, which was sent to respondents. And this was a web-based survey methodology that we used. So we had 21 items measuring five constructs in our research. And all the scales, the 21 scales, they were either adapted or adopted from the existing literature. This is the demographics of the respondents. So we had firms, various sizes of the firm in terms of revenue. About a quarter of the firms, they had their revenue more than $1 billion. A third had less than $3 million of revenue. So we had a big spectrum of organizations used in our survey. Various industry sectors, aerospace, chemical, computer software, and we had a total sample size of 83. 83 sample size, it looks a little small, But we did all the statistical analysis to make sure that our sample size, even though it was less than 100, it had the statistical power to really give confidence to the results. For our analytical procedure, we used software SmartPLS. So that uses this partial least square methodology. In fact, we use SmartPLS 3.0. So they have their version 3.0. So we use that. Partial least squares, it's a preferable approach where the sample size is relatively small. And it's a very conservative modeling approach that tends to underestimate rather than overestimate the final path coefficients that we have. So what it means is that it reduces the likelihood of type 1 errors. That is, you know, coming up with false positives. Right? So we did all our statistical analysis. We looked at all the Cronbach alpha values, which should be greater than 0.7. And we found that in all our constructs, we had the alpha values greater than 0.7. This gives you an overview of what those, all the constructs that are used in the research, the scales of all the constructs. So if you look at relational outcomes, so it means, you know, increased appreciation for the partner, increased respect of skills, increased overall respect for the partner, commitment to work together in the future. So all of these different scales, they point towards relational outcomes. So how is it really defined? Again, in terms of market turbulence, what does that mean? So it's, you know, changing product preferences of the customers, customers looking for new products, demand for our products from new customers, and new customers having needs that are different from existing customers. So that's what defines what market turbulence is all about. And similarly for all of the other other constructs used in the research. All the point estimates, the outer loadings of the point estimates, they were greater than 0.7, except for two of the scales. It was slightly less than 0.7. I've highlighted that 0.694 and 0.604. But what we found was that even if we excluded these two scales from our research model, it did not have any effect on the results. So we decided to just keep it in the model. All the T values were sufficient, greater than 2.96. So all the average variance extracted, they were greater than 0.5. So the validity and the reliability of all our scales, that was established. Moving on to discriminant validity. We looked at the square root of average variance extracted values. So all of those values are actually here in the diagonal that you see. And all of these values were greater than the correlation amongst latent variable scores. So what that means is if we look at this value of 0.8, so the 0.8 is greater than the corresponding row and the corresponding and the values in the corresponding column. So 0.8 is greater than 0.6. 0.8 is also greater than 0.7, 0.4, and 0.3. So that really established the discriminant validity of all our constructs used in the research. Looking at the prediction relevance of our sample and of all the constructs, so the Q-square values, they were all positive, greater than zero, which indicated sufficient predictive power of the model. So even though we had a sample size less than 100, we were assured of the predictive power of the model. Finally, the path coefficients. We had a total of 7 hypotheses, out of which 3 were supported and 4 were rejected, right? Now, instead of really looking at these values and hypotheses, which one got accepted, which one got rejected, let's go back to the model where it'll be easy to understand. And, you know, so we did all the statistical analysis and everything. Now, what does it mean? What's the story that really comes out of it? You know, that's the most important thing, right? So what we found was that there is no direct link between the supply chain collaboration level and the operational outcomes of the firm. However, there is a path that is followed through the relational outcomes. So higher collaboration levels, they lead to better relational outcomes, which in turn leads to better operational outcomes. So direct relation is not there. You may have a very good level of collaboration between the firms. However, that does not mean that you'll have better operational outcomes. But this will lead to better relational outcomes, which in turn would lead to better operational outcomes, right? And then similarly, if you look on the right-hand side of the model, we found that, you know, better relational outcomes will not lead to better operational, better organizational performance. However, better relational outcomes would lead to better operational outcomes, which in turn would lead to better organizational performance, right? And if we look at the market turbulence, that seemed to have no effect on the collaboration level and the operational outcomes or the relational outcomes, right? So what that really means is, no matter if there's market turbulence present in the external environment, as long as the relationships between the collaborating companies is strong, that would in turn lead to better operational outcomes, and that ultimately would lead to better organizational performance, right? And the market turbulence is not going to have any effect as long as the relations between the two organizations are strong, right? So this is what we really found. So no direct relationship between collaboration and relational outcomes. Relational outcomes, they mediate the relationship between collaboration and operational outcomes, and market turbulence has no effect. So there we found no effect of market turbulence as long as the relationships between the two firms are really good. So theoretical implications. So in effect, we were testing two competing sets of theories, relational view versus behavioral view, and relational view versus contingency theory. And we found that in both the cases, relational view really holds. So the competitive advantage of a firm lies in the power of relationships in which the firm is embedded. So that's the big source of competitive advantage for a firm. Implications to managers. So managers, they should focus their efforts on relational outcomes on collaborating relationships, because strong relational outcomes would lead to better operational outcomes, which ultimately would lead to better firm performance. And market turbulence, as long as the relational outcomes are strong between the collaborating firms, then the market turbulence is not going to have really any effect on the business performance. There were some limitations of the research. The data was collected only from the focal firms and not really from So we did not have any secondary data that was used in measuring the actual performance. This was all what the respondents told us. So no objective data or secondary data to verify the improvements in the firm performance. So that's one of the limitations of this research. And for any survey-based research, you'll have these limitations. Right. So that's the end of the presentation as presented. But as far as the research is concerned.
Let's give Dr. Arora a hand. This was a really great presentation. Very, very interesting. And I'm going to add another theory to your models, not to derail your research, but maybe to have some follow-up research.
Sure.
I was very reminded when you spoke about these different theories, these relational theories, of a former colleague when I taught at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. A senior colleague and mentor of mine was Dr. Romesh Diwan. So guess what? He was a landsman of yours, right? As we say.
Uh-huh. The name seems familiar, yes.
Indian. Came to the United States, I think, in the 1960s and became a very distinguished professor at Rensselaer Polytechnic of economics, my own field. And his was social economics. I was more on the ecological economics side. Mm-hmm. And he proposed a theory of Gandhian economics, a theory of relational economics, and proposed that the real wealth of wealth creation and asset creation lies not in monetary values, but in relational values. And the more robust one's relationships are, the more successful one is in establishing positive outcomes. So you should look him up. I have to dig in my, in my files to see if I still have some of his papers in electronic form. So I will forward them to you.
Sure. Yeah, that'd be very interesting. Yeah. So it's very close to the relational view, which was given by Dyer and Singh. So So that
it will be interesting to see who was first, if Ramesh Dewan was first. Or...
So Dhairan Singh, I know this wasn't in the 90s, probably 1992, 1991.
Yeah, this is going to be close. I think he first started publishing around maybe like the late 80s and early 90s. And I wrote a paper with him somewhere in the early mid 90s on that.
Uh-huh.
We were contrasting... what I called valuing sociodiversity and his views on relational economics. So it's
okay. That's very interesting. They're very interesting. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for that.
Yeah. So colleagues, floor is open, please. And maybe you can get out of screen share, Dr. Arora, so we can see each other a little bit easier on one screen, hopefully. And are there any questions, comments on this very, very interesting presentation? Kanika is asking a question. I'm wondering how supply chain concepts and relational findings could apply to a circular economy. Yeah, very, very interesting. And the circular economy, of course, is the idea is that what we would normally consider emissions and waste become a resource. So mm-hmm. that would add some additional coordination issues, right? But do you want to expand on that, Kanika?
Oh, well, that was the question. I mean, because I was thinking about the paper that's coming up, and it's the whole time you were presenting, I was thinking, I wonder how the theories that you explained, and I really like when you showed the graphic with the explaining the theories to explain the relationships that were tested. I was thinking for a circular economy, what could the similar applications be? I mean, it's an exploratory question, but I'm just curious, you know, the supply chain is one model, but then the circular economy model, how that could be adapted or explain the inner mm-hmm. workings of that model.
Yes, yes. So that's a very relevant research topic, circular economy. So at the beginning of the presentation, I was talking about the reverse logistics part, right? So how the, so that's like pretty much similar to your circular economy. So get recycling, reusing everything. And if you look at all the companies these days, I mean, they are all into, you know, trying to be more sustainable in their operations, trying to promote all the reuse so that, you know, we've got finite resources on Earth. So it just makes sense that you know, we are able to come up with some technologies which really conserve all aspects. They are conserved so that we leave our future generation with at least the same resources that we have been using. So that's a very interesting topic, and most of the companies, they are moving towards, you know, sustainable operations. If you look at Europe, they are like far ahead probably. You know, as compared to US, it's mandatory for them over there to, you know, come up with their sustainability goals and measure their sustainability goals. In US, it's not mandated by the government. It's only the economic aspects that, you know, you have to report to the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, but you don't have to report any of the social aspects, any of the environmental aspects. But companies are doing it voluntarily. If you look at all the global 500 for the 500 Fortune companies, whether it's required by the government or it's not, if you look at their, I mean, most of the companies, they are producing what's it called, the annual sustainability reports. So if you look at UPS or FedEx or automobile manufacturers, and you just Google, you know, the sustainability report 2020 of Honda, even though it's not mandated by the government, they produce those reports. They've got some metrics, some specific metrics that they report to their shareholders and to the stakeholders every year. And they've come up with those targets, even though it's not mandated by the government in US. So organizations, they understand. I mean, just to give you an example, UPS, right? It's a logistics company, right? They are in the business of burning fuel, right? So if they are able to reduce their consumption of fuel, they are going to affect their bottom line, right? More profitability if they're able to reduce that. And they are also going to reduce the environmental impact, right? So most companies understand that environmental aspects, they have a direct relationship with their economic aspects, right? And we need to create an economy which is sustainable in itself, right? So it's a great research topic, and so many companies, and it's relevant to the managers, I would say. So any research topic that we, or a research direction that we want to go in, we should keep in mind that how is it relevant to the managers, to the businessman. I mean, I'm more of a business professor, so I'll talk from their point of view. How is it relevant to the business managers? Right? So that's what any topic should be geared towards.
And I've neglected to thank you also for laying out your research question and hypothesis so clearly. Some of the students have already taken statistics and quantitative methods. Others will take it in the spring. But you just gave a really wonderful summary of why it's important to logically think through these things. And you're way ahead when you do that. Before you start writing your paper, if you have that outline clear and your conceptual framework clear. So thank you for laying it out so beautifully.
Thank you. Yeah. So I thought it'll be beneficial. I mean, so when you start working on any research project, we should have a very relevant research question in mind. You don't have to have like five research questions. Even one or two really relevant research questions would make your research worthwhile. So
absolutely. Nice. Yeah. Thank you. Other questions or comments?
I thought it was an interesting observation of the importance of relationships and the possibility of having collaborations across different organizations in the supply chain, because that's complex and something that isn't going to normally be covered in coursework.
Yes, that's right. So, I mean, the picture that I showed of a supply chain, right, that's a very simplified version of a supply chain. So where we just had one supplier, one manufacturer, one distributor, and one retailer, right? But think about it, in the real world, it's much more complicated. So if we take the example of Honda, right? So Honda has its headquarters in Japan, but they've got manufacturing facilities in probably about 80 different countries. And if you look at their suppliers, you've got probably thousands of suppliers all over the world, and you've got millions of customers all over the world. So very quickly from a supply chain, it becomes a supply network. And then if you have to look at collaborative relationships between your all your suppliers, it's just impossible to do it. Most organizations, if they have to develop relationships with their suppliers, they'll probably go to tier one or tier two. But you probably have 6 or 7 or 8 tiers of your suppliers, right? So it's just impossible. I mean, it's possible, but then it needs huge investments, which is going to be very inefficient. So most companies probably they will build their relationships with tier one or tier two suppliers, and then maybe tier one distributors. On the demand side, it's really important to build those relationships. But again, you're looking at hundreds and thousands of entities and then millions of customers. So to keep all that supply chain moving efficiently and effectively, that's organizationally complex, right? So it's an interesting thing. So it's not a very simple concept of just one little chain. It's like a huge web of supply chain.
You haven't talked that much about the applications of, as the network grows, I mean, it grows exponentially as you add on more and more nodes in it. You haven't talked about using, say, data science as a way to facilitate that.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So in a supply chain, it's all about you've got so many data points, right? So most organizations, let me show you a graph which really talks about industry trends and some research topics that are relevant in today's world. Let me quickly share my screen. Yeah, right here. So this is by DHL, and they come up with their with this radar. They call it the radar every year, and this is the latest one that they have. So if you look at their different trends, let me see if I can. Yeah. So you have different trends, and as you move away from the center, this shows the relevancy in terms of time period. So anything within this white line, the white circle, is relevant in the short term, less than 5 years, and beyond that it's relevant from 5 to 10 years, right? And as you move towards the center of the circle, this red line over here, that means this particular trend is going to have a higher impact. And as you move away, that's a lower impact. So you've got different areas of research. It includes artificial intelligence, self-driving vehicles, right? Big data analytics, right? Supply chain is all about data. If you can manage that data efficiently, you can have a more efficient supply chain. So big data analytics, it's relevant in a very short term, and it has a high impact, right? Robotics and automation, that's another area. And if you go towards omni-channel logistics, so that's omni-channel is different channels. So it could be the brick and mortar, it could be your electronic channel, right? So all of that. Silver economy, there is sustainable logistics. So again, circular economy and sustainable logistics. Sharing economy. So that's all about, you know, your DoorDash and Uber. So that's all about shared economy model, Airbnb, right? And all of that is getting embedded in logistics too, right? So there are many startup companies in the area of logistics and supply chain, which are making use of this sharing economy model. So there are 3D printing, blockchain, that's another big trend, blockchain in supply chains, right? So lots of areas where you can, you know, start off with your research. So some ideas, so I just thought I'll share it with you all. This is by DHL, and maybe I can just copy this link and paste it in the chat box. You can have a look at it.
Yeah, thank you. That's great.
Yeah, that's right here. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, moving towards the data and the big data and the analytics side, that's a whole different way of looking at supply chain, but that's a very, very interesting area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you for sharing that link. And the whole whole idea of the sharing economy is also huge, and remains to be seen how it's going to shape up after COVID. Mm-hmm. There are going to be implications. This is bike share, car share, sharing rugs rather than owning, you lease, and so forth. So there's a whole big trend of sharing economy. You know, one of the things that strikes me particularly when it comes to food, but also more generally consumer goods. So in my area of research in ecological economics, there's been quite a bit of thinking, sort of, you know, conceptual papers and so forth, flying back and forth about the impact of COVID on the length of supply chains. And of course, the idea being that now we don't go to the stores, but we want everything delivered right to our doorstep. And so that adds a number of other logistics points. And so how does that both increase the pressure on environmental systems and social systems? Because it's often this, you referred earlier to the last mile, that is a very vulnerable workforce often and very low paid workforce. And so what are the implications of that? And are they here to stay? Are we going to continue now that we've gotten accustomed to the convenience? What are the longer term impacts of this increase to the supply chain? Because there's this added step that we didn't have when we went to the large retailers and box stores.
Mm-hmm. Can I add another concept to that, Dr. O'Hara?
Go ahead.
Which is adding the cold chain, which I think has obviously really big implications for sustainability. I mean, if you go to Trader Joe's, they have pizzas that are in the frozen section that were made in Italy. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, so that's something that's more sort of a trifle, but then, you know, the vaccines, ones that require very cold temperatures in the cold chain. I mean, these really point to some weakness in their ability to be sustainable.
Yes.
Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, that's another interesting area of research, the pharmaceutical supply chains, the cold supply chains. where you have, you know, products all the way from Europe or all the way from Asia, the food products that have to be delivered at a store in US in the same fresh container and the fresh packaging, and pharmaceuticals. I mean, the COVID-19 vaccine, this has to be maintained. I think I was reading somewhere, it's like minus 70 degrees Fahrenheit or something.
That's one of the vaccines, Pfizer.
Yeah. So that has to be transported, and then you need specialized glass containers, and the company Corning, they have been manufacturing those glass vials to make sure that there is no reaction with the outside atmosphere. And then you've
There was a piece in the New Yorker about the vial production and the one that Corning's making. There's also, I've already heard that there's already shortages of dry ice.
Yes, dry ice, you to keep that temperature at the super low temperature that you have to have. All these dry ice manufacturers, the glass manufacturers, I mean, producing the vaccine is one thing, and to really transporting it using the concept of your cold supply chains to the ultimate customers, you and me, that's going to be a bigger logistical challenge than, you know, coming up with a vaccine. I think now we've got so many companies working on it. We are going to be successful in that. But then logistically speaking, how to transport it all over US and all over the world. I mean, people, you've got like 7.5 billion people on Earth. How to vaccinate all of them. You've got to go to Africa where the infrastructure is not that great. Go to Asia where the infrastructure is not that great. But still, we need to make sure that we vaccinate all those people. Last mile delivery and cold chains, that's a hot topic right now. Everyone is talking about it, and it's relevant to the managers, to the industry, and to the researchers. So that's...
I could blab about it for a while.
In the chat, we have a question about the supply chain of food specifically, and what have we learned about the resilience or lack thereof of the food supply chain, particularly during this pandemic?
So resilience is a great word. I mean, everyone is talking about risk and resiliency right now, right? All our supply chains, the traditional models that we had, what we thought can work, you know, forever, industries have been disrupted. The successful ones are going to be the ones who are going to be resilient. And the ones who are going to be resilient are the ones that are going to be adaptable and flexible. We need to have flexible supply chains, adaptable supply chains. Globalization, you know, that led to longer and more complicated supply chains. We've got our supply chains deep into China, into Asia. Companies are rethinking all that. There's this another concept of reshoring or nearshoring. So companies are trying to shorten their supply chains in order to reduce the lead times, right? So the ones who are able to quickly adapt and be flexible in terms of their supply chains probably are the ones who are going to be more resilient, not just in agriculture, but in every aspect, consumer goods or anything, right? Agricultural supply chains, again, they are, again, it ties into your cold supply chains also. And of course, we are having a growing population all across the world, right? We were like 6 billion, moved to 7 billion, 7.5 billion. So how to sustain that population in terms of agriculture, that's another big logistical challenge. You've got companies coming up with newer technologies. You've got all this genetically modified stuff, which we feel that, you know, it's not good. But if you go to some parts of the world, you know, where there's shortage of food supplies and the agricultural supply chains are not really developed, it's a boon for countries in Africa, all this GMO and all. We think it's not good because we have a variety, right? The US is a rich country, we have options. But then if you go to some parts in Africa where there are no options and you have GMO cotton and GMO food products, which can be produced with using less resources, it's a boon over there. So companies like Conagra or another companies, very controversial company into GMOs, but then it's doing some good stuff in different parts of the world. So that's another research area, right? So supply chains are everywhere. You think about anything, it has a supply chain, right? So probably after today's presentation and all the interaction that we've had, you'll think about supply chains in a very different perspective, right? Mm-hmm. Hopefully there's some takeaway from today's interaction.
And we are unfortunately out of time, even though there would be a lot more we could talk about. So we will just have to have you back for a future seminar and future meeting with the PhD students. Dr. Arora, it's been a real pleasure. Thank you for sharing your knowledge with us and your newest research. And this was a very valuable seminar. Thank you all for your participation, for your great questions along the way. And I know those of you who are taking our studio have a review session coming up. So I don't want to keep you because I just had a little icon popping up on my screen that the review session is about to start. So I know you're back to back. It's the end of the semester. What can we say? We're all really, really busy. But thank you for spending your time with us. This was really a great presentation. Appreciate it. And thank you all for your participation. And I'll see you in the new year. The schedule for the spring semester seminars will be going out shortly. Have a great break, everyone, and a successful end of the fall semester. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. O'Hara, for this opportunity. And
happy holidays.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right, thank you so much.